The Beast TV. What was that? You better get a fresh dip and buckle up. Porsche II, how you doing tonight?
Man, I'm doing great and can't wait to get into this show.
Wow, what a guest we have tonight. And we want to thank everyone that's in our chat room. I see too many names up here, and I don't want to leave nobody out, but we thank everyone. You mean so much to us for coming into the live chat. And I'm just excited. I mean, for years, I have been hearing about this lady and the work that she's done. And so I don't know. Have you got anything that you want to add before you bring her on?
Well, all I can say is we're going to do the questions toward the end of the show, and our moderators are going to be moderating and looking for good comments, bad comments, and don't be one of the bad ones.
And I want to add that we have had to go from OBS to Yard Dog. And I had a problem because it's web-based and cloud-based. And so I wasn't able to even watch chat and have slideshows at the same time. And we had one of our viewers gift me a laptop. And I just want to thank that person. And I'm not going to mention this person's name, but hopefully it will be one less train wreck, Larry. And having to swap this stuff around. So we just I want to personally thank him, and let's go ahead and bring on our guest.
Well, our guest tonight is coming to us from East Tennessee. We've all heard the story of her grandfather and Fox, and read the book that Miss Mary Green wrote, 50 Years with Bigfoot. And the lady we're talking about is none other than Janice Carter. Welcome
Hello,
to the
everyone.
Show. Hello.
It's so great to have you on the show tonight.
I'm just
gonna soak all of this up because I'm really excited, and I'm sure everybody on here knows who you are, and has followed you over the years. And so I hope some of our questions aren't repetitive, but I'm just going to start off by asking, what is your earliest memory of there were Bigfoot out in the woods?
My earliest memory started when I was about 3.5 years old, and at that time, my grandparents had taken me to the Atlanta Zoo, and there used to be a big gorilla in the Atlanta Zoo. His name was Willie B. And Willie B would break out periodically of his enclosure and escape. I was looking across the ravine, which we called a ditch line at the time, and I saw who I thought was Willie B in the tree line. You know, and it was fox at the time, but at that time I wasn't familiar with fox. So I called my mother at the time, and she came out and she was like, "Oh, there's this big, gorilla over there. Get in the house, get in the house." And finally, my grandfather was called out, and he told all of us, he said, "Just go in the house, it's fine, just get in the house." So we went in the house, and at that time, I assumed that this was this gorilla, and he had come from Atlanta to see me. But that is my earliest childhood memory, with the exception of, once again, my grandmother had an Oriental Persian rug in her living room at the time, and I think I was right at 4 and a half years old. And I had this little Tonka trunk, it was a dump truck, and she had given me some flour and water because she was making biscuits or something. And I decided I was going to mix it up in this dump truck. So I went around the edge of her Persian rug dumping dough. And at that time, Fox entered the house. And I know it was him, but at the time it didn't really register with me that this wasn't another person just coming into the house, And I remember that my grandmother was having a fit. She told me to go to my room, blah, blah, blah. And I didn't really get a good visual of him at that time. And I was a little scared, but I thought, okay, now somebody's broken into the house, that wasn't welcome. And here I was, and I'd made a mess in my grandmother's floor. But those are my earliest childhood memories up to the time when I ran into the back of his leg when we were blackberry picking, and I was 7 and a half then.
That's pretty cool. For the ones that may not know the story for some reason or another, can you go back and tell us the story of your grandfather and Fox, how that came to be?
My grandfather had purchased the land in 1944, I think. But they were clearing, him and Ralph Albert Hart were clearing the property for pasture in 1947. And they either cut a tree down and Fox was in the tree, or the tree fell on Fox. I don't know, but he was a child at the time, and my grandfather took him in, took him to the house. They checked all over at the neighbors because back then, if you had a child that had some sort of disability, you either put him in the institution or you kept him at home in the house, locked in a room somewhere. After checking all the neighbors and everything, and calling the police officers and everything, they realized that this was not some unique disabled child. So they took him in the house to begin with, and my grandmother said that he tried to tear the house apart, and I don't know whether his parents were in on that act or not. But eventually, my grandfather took him up to the barn, put him in the middle stall of the front barn. We have two barns that on the old property, and his parents came along and ripped the whole front end of that barn stall out. It was the middle stall in the front, and my grandfather never did have that stall fixed. Got so that my grandfather would be out working in the garden, bush hogging, farming the farm, and Fox would come up to him and they built a relationship. They carried on for actually several generations.
What all did your grandparents teach you about Fox and to be able to interact with him?
Well, my grandfather, I thought the sun rose and shined in my grandfather. He was my hero. And I would follow him around. He introduced me after I ran into Foxy's leg. I was about, that was in like July. And in October, He took me up on the hill and introduced me to his fox. And Sheba was there. They had the twins at the time, and they were little. And my grandfather said, treat them like the Edomites. They're another type of people. My grandfather and my grandmother looked to the Bible for answers. And if it wasn't in the Bible, it did not exist. So, because of the fact that Esau was a hairy man and supposedly red and of a different nation, my grandfather said, okay, these are the Edomites. And you treat them with respect. And you try to understand them and everything. And I know a lot of people don't understand them when they talk, but they do talk and they do speak English. And I got so that I would follow them wherever I could. And I thought they couldn't get to me up in a high tree. So I'd climb a tree and be up at the top of the tree, taking and eavesdropping and spying on them. I was just fascinated with them. If I heard them say a word, my grandfather gave me this little teeny tiny notebook pads that people used to take little notes in and write down dates and stuff. And I'd write down a r word and I'd run to him. And I'm sorry, I'm dyslexic. I still am. So my writing is not that good. But I would take the words to him and I'd say, Grandpa, what do, and I called him Grandpa. I said, Grandpa, what does this word mean? What are they saying? And he would help me. And then when I got older, I would just directly ask Fox, Sheba, or one of them, what are you asking? What are you saying? And they would tell me in English what they said. And I haven't stopped learning yet. Because their vocabulary and their own language is far more than what ours is.
So often we hear of audio clips of gibberish. Now, and that seems to be, it seems to be a language, and it seems to be sped up, I would say 3 times at least. Now, when you communicated with them, did they slow their speech down so that you could understand?
If you ask them, they will slow their speech down for you so that you can understand what they say. It still comes from the diaphragm when they speak. It doesn't come from the throat or the mouth like ours. It comes actually from the chest, the diaphragm. And it comes out, the males are very, very deep baritone. So it sounds sometimes like when they're saying hello, it sounds like they're actually growling, but they're not. And most of the women are, and I'm sorry I call them people because they are a people. There's a picture of my partner in crime, William Henry. But the females are really, really high pitched, and then of course the children are just children. They're either high pitched or they're deep pitched. And it's sometimes hard to understand them when they speak, but if you ask them to slow that speech down, they speak backwards sentence structure from what we do. So if they're asking you, who are you? Or do you want goodwill? In other words, do you come with goodness in your heart? Do you want to be friendly? It's asked backwards from what we would ask that question. There's little Dan. And Holly, when she was little, would you all get these pictures now? I didn't send these.
That Mark, he knows where to go to get them.
He's slick. I'd watch out for him.
This is their alphabet. They have their own writing. They have their own glyphs, which are tree glyphs. They write on rocks and trees and different things. Hard. Boy, y'all come up with a lot of stuff that I didn't even know was on the internet. But that's okay. But they do have their own language and everything. A lot of it goes back to Sanskrit and Phoenician and ancient text. Before Professor Wagner, Roy Wagner at the University of Virginia, before he passed away a couple years ago there, he was with me out, one of my colleagues out in the field. He's a culture was a cultural anthropologist, and we documented a lot of their language.
That's pretty awesome. And I just, it's amazing to me that you have had this interaction with them, that you can do that, because so many of us, like Larry and I, we go out there and we're just campers. And
Very much, yeah.
but to have this interaction with them, and to grow up with them, knowing that they were just another creature that was in the woods. It's just simply amazing. Go ahead, Larry.
Well, Janice, you were kind of acclimated to them because of the accident with Fox and your grandfather there. But do you think, well, I know now you know enough to build a relationship with them without that, but what would be the key for someone to build a relationship with them that don't have the acclimation that you did?
That being said, I do want to forewarn people, and I do this, I do not advise going out and trying to interact with them unless you are really dedicated to this. And they are fearsome. They can scare the living daylights out of you. They use different methods to try to intimidate you and run you out of the woods. They are not your big, friendly, cuddly teddy bears. They observe personal space, and if you get too close, they're going to come at you. And that's just the truth of the matter, unless you are have built up a long relationship with them and they totally trust you. That said, if you want to start building a relationship, the best thing is to try to do trade with them. And that being said, for instance, we'll trade everything from pebbles to marbles to animal, bird feathers, animal skins. I've traded blankets. I mean, and we try to interact. We try to talk with them to begin with. We tell them, hey, I come with no harm, no bad intentions. I show them my arms. I don't have any weapons up my sleeve, And we want to interact with you and to get to know you, to learn from you. And usually it goes pretty good. I have had a few of them that absolutely did not want to have a thing to do with a human being. But start with small steps. Talk to the woods. Let them come to you. Do not go chasing after them. Don't do what some of these TV shows tell you to do, hooping and hollering, knocking on wood and all that stuff. That don't work. Those methods do not work. You let them come to you. Simply talk to the woods, ask them if they'll come to you.
Well, that's kind of what we do is. Now, we do primitive camping. We will study the topographical maps and try to put us in a place to where they may inhibit. And then we just hike to that area and let them come to us. And my intuition or observation, you might say, is that they are curious animals. Do you find that
They're about as curious about us as what we are about them, because given an opportunity, we go to the zoo, we observe animals in the zoo, and I'm just taking an example here, because we're curious about what they do, the animals in the zoo. Say, for instance, I'm fascinated with polar bears. Okay, so I'll go to the zoo and I observe, and I might stand there for hours on end just observing and watching the polar bears, how they interact, how they swim, what they do, how they play, how they are sociable with the mother is sociable with her cubs, and the same can be applied to any human being. And then so that said, they are a people. So observe them. And the minute we step out our door, we're in their territory. We're in their homes, And you don't go knocking on somebody's door or just go to somebody's door and walk in, You announce yourself. You say, "Hey, this is who I am. I'm friendly. I'm here, And can we interact peacefully?"
What's your most memorable interaction you've had? Is it with Fox or is it with another of his generation?
Actually, that would be with one in another location in central Tennessee, and we call him Grumpy. I'm sure that you all are aware of him because Mary Green did a lot of interacting with Grumpy before she passed away. But when we first started interacting with him, the reason we nicknamed him Grumpy was he would come down the trail. He would see our vehicles coming, and he would run down this trail and bluff charge us, but stop short of the tree line. And at the time, he was not talking. He was actually grumbling, like a grumpy old man, carrying on. So it took us about 5 years to really be able to interact well with him. And he is so smart. And the one time that I went up there and I took my professors with me, and we were I interacting, and okay, I'm going to get into the woo part, okay? They do telepath and they do remote viewing, and it's like you are looking through their eyes at yourself. Okay, if that makes any sense whatsoever to anybody. And Roy Wagner was there, and he best described that in a manuscript that has not been published, how it felt to him. But he was like, "Okay, will Grumpy come out to us?" And the other guys were like, "Will he come out to us? Will he interact with us?" And I said, "Yes." But I said, "You have a pocket knife in your pocket." Now, this was just a little old pocket knife. And I said, "He's afraid that you might cut him with that. Can you hand me that pocket knife so that he will interact with you?" And he came right out and started interacting. And I was just blown away. I was like, "Oh, thank you, dear Lord. You've cooperated. Now we can get somewhere."
Yeah, that's pretty neat. I know you said that they're a people. You just talked about mind speak and remote viewing. And I know in the past you caught a lot of flak for bringing what you know out.
I did.
And today there's a lot more people joining you saying these things. I know I've not, Mark has not had any of these things happen, but we're always open to listening to people and their experiences, and nobody's had more experience probably than you. So.
There has been people that's had just about as much, if not more, than I have, but they are reluctant to come forward with their information because you get to a point where you want to try to protect them, the Bigfoot and Sasquatch, and the only way for us to do that right now is to keep our mouths shut. Because I've had people show up on my property, show up where I was doing research at, and I've gone totally off the grid for a while trying to do productive research, and I still had them track me down and come right into my research areas, and then it puts you back because Bigfoot do not know these people, they do not want to interact with them, and it'll set you back months in research.
Well, I know probably some of the people that were bashing what you said, your knowledge, are some of the people that go crash in your research areas, aren't they?
Yeah, there has been, and I mean, I work in large circles and in small circles, if that makes any
Right.
sense.
Oh, it makes perfect sense.
And it's like, back when I first came out with the book, and I did hint at a lot of stuff, but I didn't outright say it in Mine and Mary's book, 50 Years with Bigfoot, Tennessee Chronicles Coexistence. I hinted at the telepathy because they have their own language, like I said, and I put, I don't even know here, I think a little over 200 words of their language in the book. And one of them was mind speak. And that's what they call it. They don't call it telepathy, they call it mind speak. I also hinted at the infrasound when I said that Fox was in under me in the tree. And he was making a noise, but I could not hear that noise. I hinted at the infrasound, but I never said exactly what it was.
Yeah, the infrasound's definitely become more acclimated to Bigfoot research than any of the rest because so many people have been hit that way. So,
And they do have some what we call paranormal abilities, but and they're born with it. But that being said, it's for instance, to the telepathy, telekinesis, which is the ability to move things with the mind, remote viewing, the list goes on. The infrasound is one, the eye shine is another, what we consider abnormality. But is it really for them? You have to question this. And different things that they do are a bit unusual for us. But then, if you think about it, how much of this have we forgotten? Because we live in what we consider a civilized world. But if you break down everything that you have and you take away everything, the only thing that you are left with is your instinct. And the same applies to them. So when you break that down to your natural instinct, your other senses come to the forefront to help you survive.
I agree with that. I mean, most people tell you you only use 10 to 15% of your brain, so what's the rest of it capable of? Who knows?
And
I don't claim to be a psychic or anything. I'm not, but I do have some God-given gifts. That's what I call it. Because whoever created me, I have some abilities myself, but I don't always use those. But I can blow people's minds with what I do know a lot of times.
Now, you were speaking of Mary Green earlier, and how this lady just contributed so much to this community early on.
She did.
First, tell us about the book, and I believe it's out of print, but
It
y'all, do you happen to have a copy of it that you could show up, to
is.
pull up and show us? And
Yes. Is
maybe
that?
you could find it on eBay or search the internet, but I know that you are working on republishing this book. Tell us a little bit about that.
About the book or about Mary?
Well, let's start off with the book and then we'll move to Mary.
Okay. I, of course, we've all been in different organizations, and I will not take and mention the ones that I approached. My sister and a good friend, dear friend of mine, which nobody took seriously at the time, Dallas Gilbert, he's deceased now, said, "You really need to go forward and tell your story." I approached two different organizations at the time that were the few that were on the internet, told them my story, and they called me a liar. Because at that time, we were still all in the ape camp side of the fence, so to speak. That they're a descendant of Gigantopithecus Blackie, Pithecus, or do what, Holly? Gigantopithecus. She has to correct me because I can't ever remember what they call it. And that said, I approached Mary and I said, "Mary, this is what I have to tell." And she said, "Wait a minute." She says, "I believe you." She says, "There's too much detail there. You know too much." So she came and she did the investigation. We approached Dr. Igor Borsov, of course, and Dmitry Banoff over in Russia, because they had similar stories and reports that had come in from other people or across the globe that matched up to mine. So Dmitry did his interrogation, I should say, because I mean, he questioned me the same question 50 different directions to see whether or not he could catch me in a falsehood or, you know, or a mix up, or just for instance, whether I was actually telling the truth or making up an elaborate story for the whatever reason, you know. And Mary said, "Okay, let's write a book." And I said, "Okay, I don't have a problem with it." So that's where we decided to write 50 Years with Bigfoot, which was about my grandfather's, basically his experience and the experience that I and my half sister had growing up around Fox and the family, the ones on the old farm. But Mary, my gosh, she was a database. You know, took in many, many reports, got out there in the field. God bless her. She was poor of health, and she would get out there and beat the woods. I mean, not, I'm not talking beat them, but you know, be out there, boots on the ground, doing the research, finding evidence. And, you know, I don't know how many times I've seen this woman get up off her, I'm literally saying this, get up off her deathbed and go out to investigate.
Yeah. Oh, I used to follow her blog a lot, and then it stopped, and I really didn't know why. I didn't know her personally or anything, and was very saddened to hear of her passing because she did bring a lot to the Bigfoot community just through her blog alone.
Oh, yes.
And, Larry, we've been fortunate enough to have Dan Rickey and Vicki Fulcher to be close friends of ours. And
Yep.
they were able to work with Miss Green. And we've learned a lot of insight, behind the scenes. And I just really find that really interesting to know and how much she brought to to the community. And I'm a firm believer that we stand on the shoulders that have gone before us. And
Yes.
it's we need to be a humble people, and we need to learn from our past and what other people have learned. And I think that will give us success.
Well, Jill, I'll just take for instance. Okay, we had John Green, which was one of the pioneers, okay? He's now deceased, but he was one of the pioneers. We had Bob Gimlin, who is still with us, thank the Lord. You know, him and Roger Patterson. They were out there in the day. Whether they knew exactly who these creatures were or what these creatures were, they were the groundbreaking pioneers of this research. Dmitry Baranov and Peter Burns, and the list goes on and on and on. And while I have butted heads with some of the best of them, because we don't see eye to eye, but there is a certain level of respect. And you have to respect these people for what they were doing in their day. Whether they were right or wrong, they were the ones who blazed the trails.
No doubt about that. And
And
without
I can
that,
say Lauren Coleman. Everybody likes to make fun of Lauren. Lauren has tried to discredit me and his brother. But that said, okay. Who do you go to? Cryptozoologist. Do you have something that you do not know what is? Who do you ask for advice? Say, hey, look, I have this thing and it looks like, we are dealing with this right now. You had Igor Borsov on the show a couple of weeks ago back. And while we are dealing with the Bigfoot over there in this area in Russia, we are also dealing with another hominid that we have no clue what this thing is. Igor calls it a troll. The best description that I can give you is it is about 4 foot tall. It is hair covered. It has horns on its head and a tail. The rest of it is very human looking. It does not talk. It uses telekinesis and it can be violent. It decided to set up camp in one of the guide's barns and would not leave over Christmas for 5 days. We did everything that we could think of to get this thing to leave, and it would not. And there was no reasoning with it. So, who do you go to ask, what in the world is this thing? We have no clue. We've never dealt with this before. Lauren Coleman's there. He's dealt with a lot of cryptids. He knows his, he knows his stuff. And he says, oh, well, I think that this is what they used to call an imp back in the day. The description is as good as any.
There's things that are out there that we don't have knowledge of, that peons like me and Larry, and but
Y'all are peons. Y'all are out there. I got your boots on the ground. You're doing your research.
well, we it's something that we enjoy doing, and it's a simple pleasure of life for us to be able just to be in the woods, and it's not necessarily to have an interaction. It's just being out in the woods, and everything else is just icing on the cake, whenever we do have what we believe is interactions with them. And what's for someone that is new to this and looking to get out in the field and to learn more, what advice would you offer them where to start?
Basically, what I would do, okay, first, I do not advise anybody to go out in the woods, especially in bear country and snake territory, without a gun and being armed. But you're not there to shoot and kill a Bigfoot. You're there to protect yourself. I mean, we have coyotes, we have wolves, believe it or not, we have big cats, here in Tennessee. And people are unaware of their surroundings. First, be aware of what is around you, And that said, if you are going to go into their territory, the first thing to look for is what we call ground sticks. And a lot of people don't know how to identify a ground stick. But a ground stick will be a stick or a tree that is shoved into the ground that if you sight off the tip of it that's up in the air, you're going to find another ground stick or a structure directly in front of that. If you sight the way it's leaning, and there's your first process of going about finding them and getting into their territory. And then you're going to notice an X. And an X marker can be up in the air. It can be down on the ground. If it doesn't have what we call a hanger behind it, which is a tree that is horizontal between two trees, it's a welcome sign.
Mark, are you writing all this down?
Yeah, but I guarantee you, I'm going to go back and have to watch this now. I can't listen and write at the same time. I'm kind of stupid,
I'm sorry.
But I will be going back and taking notes because
a lot of people think they have to go out into the wilderness. I'm going to tell you one thing right now. They are in our cities. They are in our little tiny parks inside of the city limits, believe it or not. That one structure that you showed just a few minutes ago, Ashley, was in the Knoxville city limits, right across from Aubrey's. No, not this one. This is just their count for their clan family members, the Rocks. And it was right across from Aubrey's restaurant, and they had sighted that restaurant in. And the minute the lights went out, they went dumpster diving behind the restaurant.
Yeah.
They're very resourceful. They will use any means to gather food for their families. I've seen them in Walmart's dumpsters getting the rotisserie chickens, you know, because at the end of the day, what does Walmart do? If people don't purchase their rotisserie chickens, they go in the dumpster.
Yeah.
Here comes Mr. and Mrs. Bigfoot. They go rummaging through that dumpster, and out with those chickens they go.
Maybe we should go to work for Walmart, Larry.
There
we can go home with rotisserie chickens.
This little structure that's here on this picture on the left-hand side, that was directly across from Aubrey's in Knoxville.
Well, I was about to ask you, do you have any idea what these structures mean? But what do you know about these structures?
Okay, this one is up right now. This is a lean-to, and this one is actually a barrier that tells the young ones you do not go this way. Only adults are allowed this way. Children are allowed that way. This is actually a bad photo of a dog pup, a dog man pup, with Big Daddy. He's in the background. But if you'll notice, this pup is up on the stump, and its tail is down the stump. It looks like a break in that stump, but it's actually got its back to us. Dogmen and Bigfoot are not the same. This right here is a fishing drying rack. This is also, this one is a glyph with some of their writings. And if you understand it and know what they're saying there, then you know actually where to go to find them. All right, on the left-hand side, this is a dogman's X. And this has the barrier that is leaning horizontally across the top. That is a no enter sign. This one, again, this is what we call a hanger. It's a barrier. It means that you are not necessarily welcome in that area.
So if that's behind the X, you're not welcome in that area.
All right. You're not welcome in that area.
That's the kind of area we like going in, though.
Well, you enter at your own risk, because I'm going to tell you one thing right now. They have accurate aim, and they will hit you with a rock, and it hurts. They'll throw little pebbles at your feet, you know, and not really hit you to begin with, but then the next one, it escalates up. And if you don't leave once they've hit you with that rock, there is going to be a bigger one coming, and then they're going to actually charge you. They're not bluff charging. They want you out of that area, and they're going to come at you full force.
Yeah.
You know, that's one thing that I noticed early on is when pebbles are being thrown at you, how accurate they are. Because a lot of times we've been in places that there was a creek in between us and a cliff, and I just knew that it was at least 50 yards away, but these pebbles were just hitting all around our feet, and I mean they could have easily have hit us with them, but I
Yes.
have surmised that they are very accurate when they throw something.
Oh, they're dead accurate. They use a lot of them when they're hunting in this they have some graphic hunting procedures methods of hunting. But one of the things that they will do is especially the females, because the males usually do the kills. The females will throw rocks. Say, for instance, here's a deer, and they're pursuing a deer, and they're sort of herding it toward the one that's going to take and actually kill it. They will throw rocks and hit that deer right in the middle of the head and knock that deer stupid. I mean, that's what it does. It just knocks the deer to the ground. The same with birds. I've seen them throw a rock and knock a bird out of the air in flight. Deadly accurate.
So what, and speaking of hunting, I know they're gonna eat a lot of vegetarian type stuff, but you say they eat deer. What is their diet from season to season?
If they can come up with game animals, and what I'm saying is they will eat everything from rodents all the way up to bear. Yes, believe it or not, they will eat bears. And they don't always eat every portion of the animal, but they do utilize a lot of the animals. For instance, if they kill a deer, they may take the liver, they may take the heart, they may take the lungs to actually eat and leave. If they're not really hungry, they'll leave the rest of it there. But if they are hungry and in need of clothing, padding, swine, whatever, then, or I call it swine. I think I can't think of what other people call the ropes that are made out of deer hide. But that being said, if they need that part, the bones can be used as hide scrapers to scrape the hair off the hide. Marrow is in the bone, and it's high in protein, high in calcium. So they're utilizing as much of the animal that they take and kill is what they possibly can. They waste not, want not. But their diet consists, I mean, like I said, rodents, everything from field mice all the way up to the bear. Vegetation, they can eat vegetation that we wouldn't even want to think about. They eat grubs, which is worms. They will eat tree beetles. They will, and the list goes on and on and on. I mean, we're not going to go out there, but if we were a survivalist, we would be out there and we would be hunting crickets or whatever is high in protein and we would eat it.
So to keep from killing out their food, do they move around a lot or they stay in one area and just utilize different hunting grounds? How do they not eat out all the deer or rabbits or whatever they're?
A lot of times, what they do is people like to say they migrate. They do not migrate. They are like a nomadic people and they will follow the game animals. But that being said, they usually have a wide range territory that they stick to. And it's just like a farmer in his crops. He'll rotate his crops in a field each year so that the soil can give back to itself, and produce better. For instance, you might plant alfalfa one year, a corn the next, and go back and let the ground life re you fertilize it and whatnot, turn it over and let the
Right.
soil lay for a year and then come back. The same with the deer. For instance, they're out there and they're hunting deer. They take the old, they don't take the young ones unless they absolutely have to. But they do realize that, for instance, the bucks, the males, that are in rut, they don't, they'll take the males. Very seldom do they take a doe. But it's
Yeah.
usually those males, the old ones, the younger ones. Every once in a while, if they are actually starving to death and it's a harsh winter, yes, they will resort to getting fawns,
Yeah.
And it's the same way with the rabbit population. And if you go into an area where they're actually hunting, you'll notice that not many animals stick close by in that vicinity
Yeah.
because the animals know.
Wow. I don't know. I've got so many questions. With someone of your knowledge and experience, it really provokes more questions and motivation to get out in the woods. And I believe that's why you and William are still out there researching. Now, what questions stand out in the forefront that you are pursuing the answers for?
I want to know about their beliefs. I want to understand their culture. I want to learn their history. And this is where I'm at. I could care less about a picture of a Bigfoot. I've seen one. I've seen, very, very many. Are we going to be able to prove they exist with film or photos of them? No, that's not going to happen. Whenever you go in and you're studying an indigenous people, you learn about their culture. You're not invasive. You don't ju You're not judgmental of their beliefs. For instance, I believe that there's a God, and I'm very spiritual. That doesn't mean I'm going over here to the Baptist church or down to the Methodist church or over to the Holiness. I'm here to learn from you. I am not going to be judgmental about your belief systems, or the way that you interact, the way that your culture is. We want to learn that. That's where I'm at, and that's where William is. He's a little bit behind me, but he's learning. He's a quick learn. He's out there with his boots on the ground. He's got my back, and that's another thing. I am the world's dumbest person when it comes to going out in the woods. The only thing that frightens me to death is a snake. I am deathly afraid of a snake. But otherwise, I'm pretty fearless. My daughter can vouch for that, that's here with me. Mama's stupid when it comes to getting out there. She says, well, she doesn't say stupid. She just says mama doesn't fear anything. But that said, William carries guns and he's got my back. If we run up against something, and we will try to let it get out of it, so go on its own way. But say, for instance, we're surrounded by a pack of wolves that are, coyotes are mo the most dangerous of what we have here in East Tennessee. And say a pack of coyotes surround us and we're out there at the nighttime. I tried to do my research during the day because I could see better. But that said, and we're surrounded by a bunch of coyotes and we have to defend ourselves. He's got my back,
Right. That's important. And
And we're trying to learn about their culture. We're trying to learn their beliefs, their language, their writing, their history, their vocabulary, you name it. It's like any other cultural anthropologist. You really want to learn about them and from them.
to this date, what's the most profound thing you've learned about them that stands out most in your mind?
That they actually discipline their children.
Unlike we do.
Like we do, they actually discipline their children.
Yeah.
I was just blown away because there was an incident with several of them. There was an incident back years ago when my youngest daughter, was about how old were you? About nine. About nine, and Top Santa, who is Grumpy's wife, their son threw a stick at my daughter, and here's this crazy woman goes charging up the hill after these Bigfoot, like I'm going to rip them a new one, you know. And I was scolding them. That said, Top Santa took hold of her son's arm and spanked his bottom just like we would, with the palm of her hand, wop, wop, wop. And you don't do something like this again because you're going to get us all in trouble. And I was just like, oh my God, I didn't know they did something like that, you know.
Yeah, that would be pretty cool to
I was just amazed. I was standing there with my mouth gaped open, you know, my jaws on the ground, you know. I'm like, oh my gosh, I didn't have a clue that they'd do something like that.
that'd be something you really wouldn't think about.
No.
I know from the simple day-to-day life. Questions on most people's minds are, where do they sleep? Why is it that we don't stumble across them whenever they're asleep on the forest floor or whatever they do? What's your answer to that one?
Okay. Misconceptions. You have to know where to look for them when they are sleeping. And they're all always going to have sentinels who actually are watching when you approach. So they generally wake each other up. But in some cases, I did work on one case in another state that you actually had Holly in the creek there. That was in Indiana. And they will hollow out in under fallen large fallen trees and line that area with leaves and branches and different things, and get up in under those trees to sleep. They also utilize caves, and I'm not talking about these overhangs. I'm talking about caves where they can actually get back into it. Cave systems maintain a temperature of 52 degrees year round, regardless if it's a deep enough cave. They do use fire. People think they don't, but they do. But it's only used to not for heat purposes, but to actually make different types of teas and stuff and medicine that they need. But they'll do that. They'll hollow out a place. It looks like somebody has dug a grave for somebody and piled up a mound on the opposite side, on one side or the other of this dugout, what looks like a dugout grave. And they'll get down in that, and they cover themselves with leaves and debris, and it's like a trap, you know. But unless you know where you're at and you step on one and fall through, you don't know that they're there, and they rest in that, you know.
Well, that lot makes a lot better sense than what Mark's is. He just says they lay up against the oak tree.
Oh no.
Thank you,
Bro,
Larry.
I need you guys out into the woods. You name the place, I'll be there, you know, and I can show you exactly what I'm talking about.
Now, Janice, going into the woods
Yeah.
and looking for evidence, it's way more complicated and complex than looking for something obvious as X's and structures and tree boughs. When you step out into the woods, what are some of the not so obvious things that you are looking for?
Not so obvious. The really tiny stick markers that are on the ground, and it's little twigs. I'll look for those because, and okay, I better back up and say this. I don't look, I feel it. You know, it's just a sense for me of where I need to go, because I'm generally, a lot of them, like I said, do telepath, and I'll say, hey, I'm here. Where do I need to go to find and look at this, that, or the other? And William's like, how in the heck? He says, I have to follow these ground sticks, and you're already where we need to be at. How do you know? And it's just, I don't know how to explain that. I think I'm just so used to it, you know, that I just know what they do and where to find them. But if I want to collect hair, for instance, and we've been down this road 25,000 times, but hair samples do not yield good DNA because the medulla does not go all the way to the end of their hair shaft. But that said, if you're going to collect hair, for instance, it's got a transparency to it. So if you see one of their twist, like they'll twist the limbs on a tree or twist a tree, they leave behind hair, but the hair is so transparent that it takes on the appearance of the background. So if you look at for that hair and you get the sunlight, and this is the best way to do it, is to put that sunlight so that it's shining down that twist. Those hairs are going to be laid right up against the bark of that twist.
You actually got a hair sample from Fox one time, didn't
I've gotten so many hair samples from
you?
the whole group. I was a part of the Erickson Project and
Yeah.
Melda Ketchum's study. She did all of she did Fox. Fox got put in there five times, believe it or not.
Yeah.
It was funny because I sent in my samples of the entire family and Fox, of course, and Igor sent in his. My partner in crime at the time, Tom Shirley, sent in his of Fox. Mary sent in hers, and Scott Carpenter also sent in.
Yeah.
So Melba is like, wait a minute, this is the same Bigfoot. How is this possible? I said, well, I sort of gave everybody a sample.
That's pretty neat.
But again, like I said, and I also gave Adrian Erickson, I also gave him a sample. So here was a sixth sample, and we were like, okay, there's no need to test this because it's already been tested multiple times, you know, on Fox.
Right.
But that said, you know, we collected in its infancy, DNA when it was in its infancy. Will Duncan was helping me out when I was actually on the farm, and Mary, you know, when we first started this, trying to get interaction again after so many years with Fox and his family, you know, and she had already passed away and everything by the time we wrote the book and I moved back to the farm and everything. But that said, well, Duncan, at the time, we went over to the back barn, which we call the poop barn at the time, to collect feces samples, which scat, whatever you want to call it. And we had that tested in New York by Todd Destel. I don't know whether you know him or not.
Yeah.
And at the time, like I said, it was in its infancy. But those scat samples that we sent came back human, which at the time they thought it was human contamination, you know, on our part. Bat, pig, and dog. I want you to tell me, did the bat eat the human and the dog and the pig and climb up in the barn loft that has no access except when you bring a 12-foot ladder to get up there?
Yeah.
Okay. A dog certainly didn't eat the human, the pig, and the bat. The pig certainly didn't do it. So the only logical explanation for why that was up there and it tested this in that DNA scat samples is a human ate the other three creatures, you know, animals, climbed up there and used the bathroom in the barn loft.
Wow.
About that?
So we did that. That was idiosyncrasy. I went to Robert Daigle and another geneticist, and I have a speech impairment, so you all have to excuse the way I pronounce the words and stuff. But we went to another person that did the DNA genetics, and again, we keep getting it back. Human with an unknown. Human with an unknown. Now we have, and the mitochondrial side, which is the mother's side, the female side, is human. But the nucleus side, which is the father's side, is an unknown, and we cannot place it. It matches nothing, absolutely nothing here on this planet. That being said, if we have nothing to test that against, we cannot call them the Nephilim. We cannot call them aliens from outer space or, unknown primate. That's all we can call because we ourselves are primates. And being that that father's side is an unknown, we're an unknown primate. They're an unknown primate. We're, they're Homo something, but what are they? Because they're not Homo Neanderthal, they're not Homo erectus, they're not Homo sapiens like we are, but they are a Homo of the genetic tree.
You just got demonetized again, Mark.
Yeah, Larry's some kind of homo himself.
No, I mean,
We know
okay.
what you mean. It was just a joke. We got you.
Okay,
But the way you.
this is not insinuating something.
No.
Some sexual preference.
Just the way YouTube is, they just listen for words and that's all. They don't hear Homo sapien or whatever. It was just a joke.
Okay. Well, if we can't have fun, we can't have anything.
That's right.
Now, we're going to have to get to the questions here really soon, but there's one thing that I want to ask.
Me too, but you go ahead, Mark.
Now, when Fox passed away, Fox's family let you know that he had passed away. Am I correct in the way that I'm phrasing it? That you were. Just tell us the story.
Okay, Pa Fox passed away in June the 10th of 2010. I was contacted by some of the Bigfoot, some of his family members, and again, here we go with the telepathy. Okay, I was contacted at the time. I lived in Lawrenceville, Georgia, and I was told to come up here to an area in Middle Tennessee. And I'm not going to disclose where this is at because he is actually buried in another area, but this was where it was at the time, and I have ongoing research in this area with them. That said, me and my daughter came up here. I went out in the woods. Holly is my youngest daughter, and she stayed behind because they did not want her to see his deceased body. I don't know for if you never did get to see him, did you? You didn't get to see him. But she stayed at a little ways back from me, and the reason that I know is I actually saw his deceased body because I was under this impression that they lived longer than what we did, and they didn't have the health issues and problems that we did. But although I did know that he had an abscess tooth that I had to get him antibiotics for at one point, and we had extracted, but that's another story in itself. But I got to see him, and they did give me a It's called a talking stick. It gives the people in their tribe the authority to speak in council. And they gifted me that. I have that. I do know where he is buried at. I do know that he is actually deceased. But that's the way the things came down. There was nobody else with us. And I know that there's been rumors that one of my cousins, my distant cousins, was with us. Other people were with us. Other people have been to his gravesite. There is only one person in this entire planet, and I'm talking Igor and everybody else, has no clue where he is buried at. William Henry does know. My daughter knows, but other than that, we are the only people that know where he is located at, where his burial ground. And I do not want anybody going in there and digging them up. And it's not wise to try to dig one up if you do stumble across their burial grounds, because you're going to have the entire tribe down on you.
I think that would be disrespectful, just as if somebody was trying to dig up one of our family members.
Oh, let me
Now,
tell you what, somebody goes down there to my grandparents' graves and my mother and my uncle, I'm going to be on them like a duck on a June bug, you know. And that's an old country saying, but you all know what I'm saying.
Hank Jr. would say he would spit a little beech nut in your eye and shoot you with a 45. And that's pretty
Amen.
much the route that I take.
Yes.
Now, you are someone that can really tell us, because so many questions pop up. What do you believe, based on your experience, is their life expectancy?
Their life expectancy is anywhere between right around 40 years of age. They do have health problems, just the same as we do. A good range is from 40 to 150 years old. And I know that sounds outrageous, but yes, they can live a little longer than what we do.
Well, they eat a lot better than we do, honestly. With their diet, it's more natural.
It is. And that said, also I have my theories. I can't prove this yet because I do not have a deceased one on the table where we can actually study, what organs and what are in it, like biology. I think everybody has had to dissect a frog in biology at one point or another. Okay, so you go in and you're pulling out the organs. I have a theory that their appendix is still intact, which is used to work in us to break down toxins so that we could actually, for instance, you get rotten meat. We can't eat rotten meat. We're going to, have all kinds of bad things. However, they can. So if that appendix is still intact and it's still taking out all those toxins and all those poisons, and before it flushes through to your liver and on down into your kidneys and everything, that would allow for them to eat differently from what we do ourselves without getting Salmonella, E. coli, or any of the other contaminants, food poison, or anything like that.
Okay, before you ask your question, Larry, we want to let everyone know that if you've got questions for Miss Janice, put them in all caps and I will bring them up.
All right. My question is just quickly, the generations you've known since Fox and about the farm, if the barns are still standing and any of that jazz. You don't have to be specific on locations, nothing like that. Just if the structures are still there and just how many generations you know of since Fox.
Okay, since Fox, there's four generations since Fox. He's got great grandchildren that are living now, or great great grandchildren, I should say. So that would be how my, okay, children, grandchildren, great grandchildren, great great, four generations of grandchildren, and family members that are still alive that I do interact with. My daughter here interacts with one of the grandsons, and he's the largest of this particular family group. He is 12 foot 2 inches tall and has a broad shoulder span of 8 foot. He is a massive Bigfoot, you know. He's a big old boy, but they're friends. Yes, let me tell you. Nothing quite like trying to chase after your child when she's running out to a huge person that could rip you to pieces in a matter of seconds.
Yeah, I can imagine.
But and as the front barn is still standing, the back barn, when I was down there a few months ago, me and William and Holly was still standing on the back side of the property. Another man does own the property now. My sister owns the property, or my half sister Lila, and her husband own the property that is up front and has the front barn on it. The back barn belongs to another man who I sold my portion of the property to. And while he is generous enough to let us go in there and do some research, it's really not profitable because the only one that inhabits that area now is Blackie and his family, and he is not to be trusted. He is dangerous. And William, there, those sketches there of Blackie, William did that. He's had his encounters with Blackie, as have several other people. And you have to be on your toes around Blackie. And he is the one Bigfoot in this entire planet that I would not hesitate to blow his brains out. If he did something to try to harm my family members, my friends, you better believe it. I have pulled a gun on him before.
All right. Before we
And I'm
ask
in business. I'm in business.
Bomber's question, I got another question. Why are they so standoffish with us? Why are they so apprehensive?
Because back during the wars, okay, here in America, now this is not to be said for other ones in other countries, but here they've watched our wars. They watched us, you know, shoot with guns, and anything that they perceive as a loud bang can actually kill and harm them. They are very aware that we carry weapons, that we are a fright and flight being, you know, because we get scared. What do? We either stand up and try to face our fears, or we run. And it's like a person with a loaded gun. If you jump out from behind a door and they've got the gun cocked and their finger on the trigger, what's going to happen? What's going to happen? You're going to get shot. And the same applies with them. They're not a stupid animal. They are highly, highly intelligent. And they tend to shy away from us. They'll feel us out. And what I mean by feeling us out is they observe us to see what type of intent, what our body language says about us, whether we're comfortable, whether we're willing to accept how they look, because they do know that they appear big and frightful to us. And they're all individuals. They all have their individual looks, just like we do. But when you have one, for instance, I'm sure that everybody has seen Matilda of the Kentucky Erickson Project there. I don't know whether you have or not, but anyway, she has what everybody wants to call canines, which are not canines at all, that overlaps her lips. Okay, she is a total hyperpsychosis being. That being said, hyperpsychosis is it's more than a hair suit. It is all over body hair covering. That means face and everything. So her face is basically covered in hair, even her eyelids. Her teeth overhang her bottom lip, and they are not canines. They are simple eye teeth. Okay, but she knows that she is scary in appearance. Therefore, she's a little shy. She tries to, she would try to begin with get behind the brush, only give us glimpses and whatnot of her until she understood, hey, we're not judging you by your appearance.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Okay, our friend Bomber asked, Janice, what do Sasquatch say are our human beginnings?
Okay, very interesting. I've been down this trail before. They say that they were here before us. That and they do believe in God. They say that when the and they call him the Creator. When the Creator created everybody, he created everybody at one time. However, he created them a little bit before he did us, is their belief. They think that we were created to populate the earth. Then Adam and Eve were put in the Garden of Eden as keepers of that specifically, that garden. Because, and it sort of makes sense to me because when you get into reading the Bible, and I'm not trying to be, mix religion with Bigfoot, okay? This is not what I'm here to do. But if you read the Bible, and after Cain kills his brother, Abel, he goes to the land of Nod, which at that time were giant people that lived in the land of Nod. It doesn't say that they're hair suits. It just simply says that they were of, giant status. Okay. And he marries and takes his wife from that land of Nod. And you can, it's like, okay, Cain did not marry his sister. He married someone else. If nobody except Adam and Eve and Cain were here on this planet, where did he find his wife?
That's
You
true.
see where I'm going with this?
Yeah. And
So it sort of makes sense.
yeah.
I'm not saying they're right, I'm not saying they're wrong, but it's like, light bulb, what are we doing here?
Right. I agree. All right. Paranormal Heart Podcast asks, what do you think Bigfoot is? A natural animal guardian, etc.?
I think they're a natural being. I think they're a natural type of human type being. There
Okay.
are people. They
Wow.
have some what we call paranormal, but if you take the ancient Greek Latin meaning of para, para means partial normal. Put it together.
Okay, let me find the next question.
You got it.
I'm working on it. I hope I haven't missed one.
You missed one.
Did I?
You're fired.
Good.
Yeah,
Okay. J.M. Marauer?
that's a
Oh, I.
jammerer
Jammerer. Okay, I butchered that
or
again.
jammerer.
Okay.
Can they cause long-term health issues in humans?
Yes, most definitely. If they hit
Elaborate.
you with, okay, if they hit you with what I call infrasound, which is a frequency wave that is a sound, yeah, below 20 hertz. If they hit you with that sound and they keep on for a period of time, more than several seconds with that, it's going to affect you. It almost acts as radiation poisoning to your system. It affects your internal organs. For instance, I've had people have nosebleeds. I've had people that urinated and passed blood, spit up blood, total disoriented, and physically sick. That is about the worst, unless they're actually attacking you. And I did have a friend of mine that got between a mother and her child, and she headbutted him in the head and caused him a brain injury.
Wow.
Wow.
That's not a good time.
It's not a good thing. It's not a good thing. I mean, you literally, when you're interacting with them, you're doing it at your own risk. Because they're not friendly teddy bears. They just simply aren't.
All right. Lori Russell asked, Janice, are you still considering publishing more books? There are so many of us that are interested to read it. Thank you and hope to meet you someday down the road.
Yes. Me and a close friend of mine are going to republish 50 Years with Bigfoot, the Tennessee Chronicles of Coexistence. We're going to lead off with that. We're also going to lead off with Mary Greene's book. I am the co-author, by the way, on 50 Years. We're going to lead off with Mary's book of her research, which is called Bigfoot at My Door. And then I have a total unpublished research, and it's sort of a dry read because my anthropologist also have added to their experience and their knowledge to it. But it's all about the research, developing situations, what we've learned about how they measure, how, their culture and all of this. And that I want to follow the 50 years heels of the 50 years of Bigfoot once we republish and come out with this. And it may take two or three books to compile all of this into one book, one major book. Because, I mean, there is so much to this that, it hasn't been brought forth to the public.
Okay, Roxanne asked, your daughter mentioned something about a cat woman on manimal research. Can you elaborate?
Oops. Holly says, oops. She's over in the background. Yes, I can. Okay. That said, there are other type hominids besides of just the Bigfoot. The cat people, and maybe I shouldn't say this, but they have a cat-like appearance face-wise and structure-wise, up from the shoulders, the collarbone area, up. Their faces look a lot like cats. They also have what we used to call a hare lip, which is a split right in under their nostrils, which also gives that appearance of being a cat-like person. They are a Bigfoot. For the most part, they are Bigfoot. They just have different features, and therefore we call them cat people because they have a tendency to group together when they have a deformity of this nature, and I don't know what else to call it, but their hare lips. So therefore, their speech is more slurred. It's like talking with someone that doesn't have a closed palate.
All right. Jeremy Scott asks, what are your thoughts on the paranormal aspects of these beings?
What are my thoughts? Be careful of what you ask for. Be careful what you ask for. I mean, I have been dumped. I've had everything imaginable dumped in my lap. I just deal with it and move forward.
Right.
You know, I mean, the worst thing that they can do is move something with their mind and toss a log at you that way.
Right.
Okay, our friend Diane Fowler asked Janice, how often do you still visit with them?
About every weekend. I'm out
That's
in the woods
pretty
almost
often.
every weekend. I know that you all tried to catch me this past weekend, and I told you I'm out and I don't have good signal. That's where I was at. I was out there interacting with them, actually developing a situation with another group, with another new to the idea people that have them on their property that are trying to develop good interaction, good relations.
Yeah. All right. Christy Sci-Fi Gal asks, what is the word for stop in their language?
Okay, hang on. Nay. It's like a nay. It's like a, almost like a, you're saying, like you're scolding a dog.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, I do that to Mark all the time. I don't
Okay.
know. It must be natural.
Nay. Instead of fully German words, nay.
What is a, well, this is from Jamie. What is a pet peeve of humans they have about humans? I guess I should.
Okay. Holly, don't you dare. Okay.
Uh-oh.
Come on, Holly. Come on here.
No. We were on another podcast, and I know this is going to sound totally crazy, but my daughter was on the podcast, and they were communicating and directing her on what to say. I had no clue my child knew as much as she did. And I'm sitting here, and I'm like, it was discussing the birthing process with the females and what they did. And I'm like, okay, this Holly has never been around one who has actually given birth. How in the world is she getting this information and getting it correct? And then I realized what was going on. So she's turning her head this way, like she's listening to somebody over here that's not here, you know? And I'm like, okay, all right, now I know what's going on.
Yeah.
So Grumpy pops into my head from afar. He's not in my room with me, you know. And he says, have her listen to me. And I'm like, I can't make her listen to you. She's on this, you know, TV. And they call everything a box. But anyway, so finally she pauses and there was a question asked. What was that question? Oh, it was about telepathy that was asked. And before she thought to stop and not say what he said to her, she mumbles. Thank God she didn't say it out loud, but it still can be caught on that broadcast. Humans are so stupid at times. You know, they think that we are stupid because we don't understand that these abilities that they have are natural. They're natural to them. And they will call us wooden heads, which means that we're hard-headed.
Well, they probably call me and Larry knuckleheads.
I guarantee it.
Okay.
All right, our buddy Mike McSwain
Yeah.
asks,
My
are they monogamous? Do they keep the same mate? And approximately how many children are born in a family unit?
Some of them are monogamous, other ones are not.
They're
Some
just
of them
like.
are. I'm sorry, but some of them are loose. I'll put it nicely. They're very loose.
Yeah.
Usually, if they do take a mate, if they take a wife or a husband, and it's more serious of a crime for a female to cheat on her husband than a male to take another mate, you know, or cheat on his wife, because there are laws and disciplinary procedures that go along with this. They will cut off the female's nose if she cheats on her husband.
Wow.
Wow.
I mean, it is what it is. I don't want that happening to me, but so I'm gonna be faithful. But that said, the males will usually take and have more than one wife if they can support that one, that other one. They usually stay together for life until one of them is deceased. Then they'll go forth and try to take another wife or another husband. There is a way that they can divorce each other, and they call it throwing you away.
Yeah.
And that's simply if the mate, the male or the female, has done something that is uncalled for. It doesn't have to be cheating. It can be something like they're fussing and fighting all the time, and they do.
Yeah.
They're just like us. And they're unbearable and they can't be lived with. Then they can push everything out that belongs to whichever one is causing the problem and say, I
Yeah.
toss you away. And it's their divorce procedures.
So how many children do the females typically have in a lifetime?
Generally, they'll have about three. Sometimes they have up to a total of about 12.
Wow.
Wow.
They're
Wow.
busy then.
Okay, Jeremy Scott asked, what makes Blackie such a shady critter?
I think that he is sort of mentally challenged. I hate to say this, but he's not exactly the brightest light bulb in the box.
Like
I
Larry.
think no, I'm serious. I'm serious. And
Yeah.
this is coming from a psychiatric background, which I do have studied psychology. That said, he has a shorter his head structure isn't quite right because a lot of them will look like they have downs. He looks like someone who has limited intelligence, let's put that way.
Yeah.
That said, he also poses a threat because he was the one, and I'm not going to mention any names, but he was the one that raped a young girl back in the day.
Wow.
And I think that he may be, I don't know whether, I'm not trying to offend anybody by saying this, but I think he may have a maybe a bit autistic.
Okay. Okay.
All right. Jammerer. Is that right, Mark? Jammerer.
You're asking the wrong one.
Did they ever tell you their history of how long they've been around? I think we kind of covered that.
Yes. Again, they think that they have been around since the beginning,
Yeah.
a little longer than what we have. Now, again, like I said, I don't want to mix the religion with evolution,
Right.
but you can find that in the Bible if you really look. Okay, we don't know how many years is a day with God. Okay,
Right.
we're just going to put it that way. That being said, we know for a fact that there were dinosaurs that roamed this planet in the day. There were hominids that roamed this planet in the day. Somewhere along that evolutionary chain, they came in, and here we are, modern human, which
Yeah.
we had DeSoto that went before us, and Homo Neanderthal, and we have now learned because of the DNA studies that a lot of the population now has anywhere between 2 to 6% Neanderthal in them.
Yeah.
And the same can be said for them. Okay, if we all go back and we start studying along the DNA chain, we all go back to Homo erectus.
Yeah. All right. Our friend and colleague, Dan Ricky, asked, when are we going to get together around the campfire and compare notes?
That's a good question.
That's a very good question.
That is a very good question, and I'm just going to be perfectly honest with you right now. I'm on a hope and a prayer. I'm living in a hotel room. I am as broke as a convict on a Christmas Sunday. But as soon as I get my feet in under me, it's a long story. I lost my job because of COVID. I've relocated back to Tennessee, and I'm just trying to get my feet in under me. As soon as I do, and I have a little bit of income and stability, I'm willing to get out there and go.
That's
You name
fair
it, I'll
enough.
be there.
Sounds good.
I'm not asking for a handout from anybody. I don't want anybody to feel sorry for me. I'm a grown woman. I can make it. I just have to figure out how, And we're all in this together, as they say. We're all
Yeah.
suffering from this COVID-19, and it is what
Yeah.
it is.
Hopefully it'll get better quick, I hope.
Oh, I'm praying.
All right, Paranormal Heart Podcast asks, why do they always seem to be blurred in the pictures?
Okay. They give out what they call bending light, bending energy, and an aura. And that aura can go forth from them. They can actually send that. A lot of people see these little orbs and whatnot in the woods where they're at. That is their essence going forth before them, okay, to fill you out. Therefore, when you take a photo of them, and I think I sent you the picture of Greg that has the anomaly of the light that's going across the top of the trees. Igor shared that picture, I think. Okay, that is that bending light, that bending of energy. And it doesn't matter when you take a picture of them, a lot of it, they'll have that like up around them, and it makes them blurry because it's like a bunch of flashlights in front of them. Or over their face, or part of their body is visible and the other part isn't,
Okay, our friend Kat asked, why do they always? Have we already asked this, Larry?
I believe we just did.
Yeah, I think we did. I
Just did.
lost my place in the chat comments, and I want to apologize if for some reason that I have missed your question,
He did it on purpose.
then
I know. Okay, don't make me choke on this soda. It's a soda-based
Put them in the comment section, and we will ask Miss Janet to answer it. Okay, now Kat has another question. Are they guardians of the land?
They do protect the land. They do give back to the land. They are very, what I like to call indigenous people, more than what I would call First Nations people. But again, it's the same principle. If you took something, if you took, for instance, if I was to go out and I have Native American in me, I am partial Native American. I don't know whether you can see it in me or not, but if I was to go out and go hunting for a deer, I'm going to thank that deer for giving its life to feed me. If I go out and I cut a tree down, and people think, okay, this woman is as batty as a dingbat, which used to be Dr. Shock Theater, that might have been before your all's time. I'm dating myself here. But anyway, that said, if I go out and I cut a tree down for firewood, I'm going to plant another tree. I'm going to give back, and I'm going to thank that tree for giving its life so that I could be warm. That's what they do. There is not a thing that they take out of their environment that they don't give back.
Okay, our friend Scott Espinosa asked, do you think they can sense human fear or emotion?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And when we do fear, I mean, even our animals, for instance, you have a dog. The dog is put on guard duty. And I'm talking about a sports sound. Okay, say I put this dog on guard and you come up and this dog is rah, 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 growling at you. If you are fearful of that, you put out a chemistry smell,
Yeah.
a pheromone that they pick up on and they can smell that. The same applies with the Bigfoot. If you notice a lot of these Bigfoot, a lot of these Sasquatch, if when they are drawn or you see them in a halfway decent photo, not a blob squatch, you'll notice that their nostrils are more of a Aboriginal, Australian Aboriginal Indigenous peoples
Yeah.
with the broad nostrils. That is so that they can breathe in and scent better than what we can with our little old tiny noses and
Yeah.
nostrils.
That makes sense. All right. Bomber asked, did you tell the new owners about Blackie beforehand, or did they find out the hard way?
No. They know. They know. They've been the one I sold the property to, the new owners.
Yeah.
They have lived close enough to us that they are very aware of what has gone on through the years.
Have they shared any encounter with Blackie with you?
They did a couple of times because Ashley back in this was before I actually sold the property to them. Fox and Nikki went over and killed a calf of theirs and brought it over as a gift to us, heaven to Betsy. You know, it's a thing. You know, you've got to watch them. They're like a bunch of children at times. But they went over and they killed his calf, a brand new calf. And I'm like, and it's a beef cattle that he raises beef cattle. And I'm like, oh my God, where in the world did you all get this from? And they told us. And I'm like, oh my Lord, now what are we going to do? You know. So here we were. We ended up having to pay for the calf, you know. But it was what it was. You know, and yes. They are very aware. They also were aware that some of the individuals are buried in close proximity to the property, and they own that property too. So, I mean, you know, and they try, they're farmers, they raise crops and everything, and they try to keep it low key. And don't want a lot of people invasively going in, running the property. It's posted no trespassing, no hunting, you know, because it is what it is. I mean, we have been bombarded by, you know, before I ever moved and sold the property to them in 2005 there, we were bombarded with every nutcase in the United States trying to come in and, you know, oh, I'm going to kill the Bigfoot. I'm going to be famous.
Okay, we've got about 5 minutes left, and so
Oh, no.
if we don't get to your question, then please put them in the comment section, and we apologize for that. But our friend Debbie Jones asked, what is the best way to communicate or create interaction with a Sasquatch when we really believe that they are close by us?
Say hello. Talk in whatever language you speak in, because they are bilingual. Say hello. I know that you're there. Would you come and peacefully interact with me? If you see a pebble on the ground and it's a white pebble, they like white pebbles for whatever reason, quartz pebbles, pick it up and stick it up in a tree branch, you know, in where the tree comes down to the trunk and say, oh, I'm going to leave this little gift for you. And would you come and be peaceful? I want to be friends. I want to learn from you. I want to be peaceful and interact with you. And I'm sorry if I've trespassed onto your territory or into your home. I didn't mean to do so.
Okay, here is a great question. And so Bird's Nest asks, why are they so attracted to human children?
Children are not judgmental. I mean, and to up and to, and the younger the child is, I know that, for instance, when we were little, before we get become of school age, and we're told that the paranormal is not normal, and we should not, we have imaginary friends. We talk to animals. I mean, it's like a Dr. Doolittle. We'll talk to our dogs. We'll talk to our cats. How do you know that that child is not actually communicating with that dog or that cat? You don't. Because we have abilities that we are told to suppress from about age 7 onward. Okay? And that's the attraction, because children do not judge them.
No, I can agree with that. All right, Joe Parker asked, how long do they carry till birth?
Right around 46 weeks. About the same as a woman, about the same as one, us, it, give or take a few weeks.
Okay, Mike Swain asks, how does Fox and Patty compare in terms of looks, hair, etc.?
To be short, in short detail, and that is another thing that is in 50 years, because I compared Patty with Sheba and also with Fox. But Fox was no, more of a Native American First Nations Cherokee type look, facial wise, robust in build. Where Patty is a, it's like trying to compare you and I against each other. I'm a female, you're a male. And again, as far as height, build, it measures up with the foot size, where, your foundation is your feet, look wise, he was less hairier than her. He was a different hair color, a different skin color from what she was, being black. And more muscular. I mean, I don't know. Other than that, they all have their individual looks. It's like you, Larry and Mark, you don't look the same to me,
I'm a lot better looking.
Now, I'm not going to say who's better looking than who I am. I'd like to be successful here. But and I look different from you all. I look different, even if we have an identical twin. There's going to be a little bit of a variance in the looks.
True.
Okay, I guess that has to be our last
We
question.
could have done 2 hours of just question and answer with Janice.
Put
I'm
them in
sorry.
the comment section, and we'll ask Miss Janice to check the YouTube video comment sections,
We'll try to have her back on
and we'll
sometime.
try to have her back on if
Yeah.
she'll put up with me and Larry. And
Well, thank you so much for giving me a platform. I do appreciate it. And a lot of people, they'll say, well, okay, they may just blow me off as a crazy old woman that I am, but that's okay. But I
well,
feel like if I can reach one person and help one person, I've done my job. I've accomplished something.
yeah.
That's how we feel about this podcast. If it helps one person to connect the dots, then it's all been worth it. But we would like to give you just a minute to say any final thoughts that you would like to say to the audience.
I want you to be safe out there. Don't go into those woods unprepared because there's a lot more than just the Bigfoot to be aware of in the woods. Know your surroundings. I would not advise you to go out there tromping around in the nighttime in the dark because we don't see well at dark and in night, and do not fall off a cliff somewhere because a lot of you all are going out there, and we do have the missing 411 people that go missing and they're never heard of again. That being said, that doesn't mean that the Bigfoot or the aliens or anything else abducted them, because it is easy to misstep and you fall off a cliff into a ravine and you're never heard of again. Be careful.
That's great advice, and I just want to thank you for your time, Miss
You're
Jen.
welcome. Thank you.
I have completely enjoyed it and been enlightened, and I'm going to go back and rewatch this and take notes because me and Larry are not so tunnel vision that we do not want to listen to others and see what we can apply to our own research. So
Definitely.
we thank you so much.
Yes,
You're
ma'am.
very welcome. And like I said, I don't think there are any experts in this field. I am certainly not an expert. I learn as I go, and there's always more to be learned.
Excellent. Excellent. It's so good to hear other people say that. We want to thank Patrick for his contribution,
Yes.
and we're going to go ahead and get off here because I'm going to be watching Moog's show that comes on right after this, and we don't want to step on his time. So, Larry, have you got any final thoughts?
I don't. I've just always heard Janice's story, always been intrigued with it, and I'm thankful to get the opportunity to talk to you about it, and thankful that you came on our show.
Thank you, and you're very welcome.
Thank you. Okay, night, night, footers.
Good night.
Night night.
Beast TV would like to welcome all of our new Facebook members. Be sure to check out our pictures and videos of possible evidence. And if you haven't checked out the Files tab, there is a wealth of information that you may find beneficial. If you would like to support Beast TV, check out our gear. We have coffee mugs, face masks, gaiters, shirts, and tank tops. The link is pinned at the top of the comment section. Everything is always marked down 20%, so come check out our junk. We want to thank all of our new subscribers and our faithful followers. Also, be sure to check out our field evidence videos and our sister channel, Beast of the Woods. That's Larry's channel. If you want to help us out, make sure that you are subscribed. Click the thumbs up button, ring the bell, and leave us a comment. We would love to hear from you. Thanks again to each of you for watching, and we will see you again. Same bat time, same bat channel. Night night, footers.
This has been a Sawdust production.